history, there has always been conflict. Throughout the centuries, world powers have had disagreements over economics and territory, natural resources and rights. The list is endless. To solve these disputes, these world powers have sometimes had to resort to war. This is the case here in the Vietnam War. It began in 1887, when Vietnam was first established. France created a grouping of French colonial territories called French Indochina. The colonial system was composed of Tonkin, Cambodia, Annam, Chokin China, and later Laos in the year 1893. Later, between 1923 and 1925, a man named Ho Chi Minh was trained by the Soviet Union as an agent of the communist intern. In 1930, he created the Indo-Chinese Communist Party at a meeting in Hong Kong. Through many complications involving Nazi Germany, French alliances, and fights for Vietnamese independence, Vietnam was split into North and South Vietnam. From there, many other countries involved with Vietnam are pulled into a war. The term Vietnam War usually just refers to a point of the Second Indochina War between the South Vietnam and North Vietnam forces. About 11 years into the war, the U.S. and other countries that were a part of the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, CEATO, joined the Republic of South Vietnam against the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese Army. The Vietnam War was caused by elements derived from the Cold War, but it was also caused by a belief that America held, that communism was threatening to expand all over the southeast area of Asia and needed to be stopped for the good of democracy. Such was the reason that the U.S. joined this war. Specifically, our interviewee was a member of the Marine Corps H&S Co., 2D Amtrak BN, FOR TRPS, and FMFLANT. He took part in the battles of Da Nang, Ano, Dong Ha, and some general battles in South Vietnam. He also served at Paris Island, South Carolina, and Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. He received the Good Conduct Medal, the Vietnam Service Medal, the National Defense Service, and the Expert Marksman Award.
So today we have Sergeant Glenn Larch here, and we're going to be asking him a few questions. So our first question is, of all the awards that you won, were any of them specific to your branch or important to have in your branch?
Awards? The military gives you medals for each campaign you were in. So my campaign was primarily Vietnam, so they awarded 3 medals for that, and that's about it, yeah.
What was your life like after coming back from serving in the military?
That's a good question. It was kind of a strange time in this country. There were a lot of people who didn't approve of the war, and so the welcome back was pretty poor. There were demonstrations, and so you didn't feel very welcomed back, so.
Did anything change between you and your family or you and your friends? Lost
touch with most of my friends from high school because I went in the Marines right after I graduated and they went off to college or whatever they were going to do as a vacation. So everyone kind of split up, went their way. By the time I got out of the military, that was 4 years later, I really had lost touch with all of them except for perhaps one or two.
In the papers that you filled out, you said you had used the amphibious tractor. So what was it like to use?
Oh, amphibious tractors. I did, my whole 4 years were in amphibious tractors. So amphibious tractors used to be used to get troops from the ship to the beach. So when you see the old movies of people coming out of these things from the ocean, that they were amphibious tractors. In Vietnam, they were used on ground as transportation, so that we would put Marines on top of the tractors rather than inside of them, and then take them to where they needed to go and do what they were going to do.
Were there any other machines that you learned how to use?
Rifles, machine guns, flamethrowers, yeah. No, but no other big machines.
Were animals involved in part of the war?
No, not that I ever saw. There may have been, but not where I was.
Was there anything that you needed to do or have to join the military?
It was pretty strenuous to get into the Marine Corps. You had to be very physically fit. It was very physically demanding. So you had to like to run. You had to like to do exercises. But other than that, I was just general intelligence, and you had to be pretty physically fit.
Were there any qualities that you had prior to joining that made it easier for you in training or battle?
No, I don't think so. No, because I went in right out of high school. So I was like you guys. I was just an old, regular old high school kid. And I just decided that, you know, going into service was the right thing for me to do. So I went in when I was 17. So I was pretty young.
What was your training like?
The training was brutal. Brutal. The Marines sent you to a place called Powers Island, which is in South Carolina. That was 12 weeks of utter, that was difficult, very, very difficult. Difficult physically and difficult mentally. The thing I remember most, back then almost everybody smoked, not like today, but back then almost everybody smoked. Well, you didn't get a cigarette until you were there 21 days and then you had to pass all these physical and mental tests in order to get a cigarette. So that's how they motivated you. So you spent 12 weeks at Powers Island learning how to become a Marine. And then we did another 4 weeks at Camp Lejeune, which is in North Carolina, which they called advanced infantry training. So, you know, sometimes when you see the guys crawling through the barbed wire and all the action going on around them, it's that kind of training. And then I went and joined an Amtrak platoon, where I learned about Amtraks. And then before I went to Vietnam, I spent, I think it was a month in California, learning how to operate in Vietnam. So it was like a month's worth of training before we got on the ship and went over.
What was your first battle like, and how did you feel going into it?
You know, when you're 17, nothing can hurt you, right? Yeah. So, I didn't really feel much. I mean, I knew people were shooting at us. I knew there was lots of activity going on. But you're kind of, maybe it's like a soccer game. You're kind of in the moment. You don't think about all the things that are going on around you. You just kind of do your job. So, I didn't have any bad feelings. I didn't have it. It was just kind of turned out to be normal. I was there for 13 months. I couldn't wait to come home. So, you know, you count the number of days down from the time you get out to about, once you get out to like the halfway point, 6 or 7 months, then you start counting every day until you go home. Right? So, the only time you really, really get scared is towards the very end because you've made it all that time. And now you've got 2 weeks before you get on a plane to come home, and you're worried, oh my God, don't let something happen now, right? So, those are probably the strongest emotions as you got very close to the end.
Did you go on any special missions or trips?
A couple special trips. Marine Corps is kind of a precautionary group as well. So we would go to the Mediterranean Sea on a cruise for 6 months. And all we would do is just cruise around the Mediterranean, which of course would be like Greece and Spain and Italy and all those countries, you know, kind of waiting for something to go bad so that you could be there immediately. So they were called Fleet Marine Forces, and it was a big deal. But the nice part was you got to get off the ship all the time and go out and leave. So I did 6 months in the Mediterranean. I did 3 months in the Caribbean. Also on a cruise, not the kind of cruise you would think of, though. This is a bunch of Marines with their equipment, you know, just kind of on a Navy ship. And then once you're in Vietnam, there were several different operations, is what they call it, right? So, I was on probably 2 or 3 very specific operations.
Was there anything you were part of that stuck to you or you remembered very well?
I remember all of it pretty well. I especially remember how hot it was. It was brutally hot, like up in the 110 to 115 degree area. It was so hot that when we came back to camp at night, they would have like a shower. I remember this like it was yesterday. But the pipe that ran from the water to the shower was sitting on the ground, while the water coming out of the shower was like 300 degrees. You couldn't even get under it until it was way, way late at night. So remember that, you were allowed 2 beers a day, so they would deliver beer to you, but it was hot beer, and it was really hot beer. So you had to learn how to drink really hot beer. Still tasted good, but it was hot beer. So I remember that, and then I remember the monsoons. The monsoons, it starts raining, and it doesn't stop. And no matter what you do, you can't sleep dry. You're always wet. Your feet are always wet. Your socks are always wet. That goes on for, I think it was like a good 3 months of just never ending rain. So, you know, the conditions were not like Pennsylvania, but that way.
What was a normal day like in training?
Well, I remember in Paris, Iran, for instance, the drill instructors would take trash cans and throw them down the middle of the aisles. That's how you woke up in the morning. So they would get you up at, I don't remember if it was 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, but it wasn't to your alarm clock. It was to these guys throwing these trash cans down the middle of the aisle. You got up, got dressed, and you immediately went out and started running. We would probably run 2 or 3 miles before breakfast. Then we go to breakfast, but then all day was some kind of training, rifle training, hand-to-hand combat training. Your days were filled, 7 days a week for those 12 weeks. So,
was your routine any different in battle than in training?
Oh yeah, completely different, yeah. I mean, training is just to make sure you're familiar with techniques. You know, it's kind of like, you guys are soccer players, it's kind of like having a drill versus being in a game. Once you get in the game, it's just totally different. Just totally different.
Are you still in contact with any other soldiers?
A couple. Probably two more specifically. One was at my wedding, so I talk to him every once in a while. And I have some friends who came back not very well. They were kind of traumatized by the whole thing. I don't think they had the fancy terms back then, what's it called now, post-stress, whatever. But they came back. But yeah, I still stay in touch with a few of them. Yeah.
Did you meet any important people while you served?
I don't know about important people, but when we were in Vietnam, they would fly in people out in the field. So it might be maybe 30, 40, 50, maybe up to 100 of us in a specific location. So they would fly comedians in. So they brought, you guys probably don't know who Martha Ray is, but Martha Ray came in. And she came into a Marine camp in an Army uniform. And we pretty much blew her off the stage, which was not very nice, but that's just what happened. And then the guy, in fact, it's running on TV now, which was Gomer Pyle. Well, Gomer Pyle's sergeant came in and spoke to us. So every once in a while, they bring in like a kind of celebrity, more than entertainment than anything else. But other than that, I'd say, no, there weren't any presidents or vice presidents or whatever.
What things did you take out of being in the military, and did you gain any special talents?
Discipline, probably the most. I went in after high school because I thought I probably needed some discipline, and so they gave it to me in spades. So military is very, very rules-based, very predictable most of the time. You have to be tremendously disciplined. And so that was very good. That really helped me a lot, I think, later in life. So I never, ever regretted being in the military. When I went in, I decided I could have gone in for either 3 or 4 years. I decided to take 4. I wish I had taken 3, because when I came back from Vietnam, I still had a year left. And that was the toughest, because after you've been to Vietnam, they come back and then have to go through drills and presentations and inspections. It just didn't mean as much anymore. So, but I think this one was by far the best. Yeah.
Was there something about your bridge that stuck out to you that made you want to join it?
I had two friends who had gone into the Marines. They kind of influenced me a lot. I don't know why. My dad was in the Navy, World War II, and I just knew I wanted to be a Marine. I don't know why necessarily, but I went to the recruiting office and signed up, and I was in. But no, other than that, I honestly don't know why I picked the Marines. Other than that, like I said, I had two pretty good friends who had gone in, and they had good things to say about.
What was your experience like being on a boat for so long?
Oh God, it was horrible. Hated being on a boat. When we went to Vietnam, it was 21 days on ship, with 6,000 guys. You don't want to be on ship with 6,000 guys. All you did was stand in line to eat, like 3 times a day. You did some exercise, you cleaned your rifle, you things to keep you busy, but it was horrible. Even then, I told you I was in the Mediterranean for 6 months floating around. Being on a ship is not fun. You're piled like 3 or 4 high in hammocks. There's no privacy. Forget about a bathroom. You're lucky if you can. It's just no privacy whatsoever or anything. So, yeah, I don't like being on a ship. I could have never been in the Navy.
And then our last question is, were there times that you sat around waiting, or was there always something going on that you wanted to be
part of? No, never really much time waiting. You know, the military's a lot like that. They kind of sit around and wait. You wait for something to happen, or you wait for orders to go do something. So, there is a lot of sitting around, but I was in 4 years, but 13 or 14 months in Vietnam, 6 months in the Med, 3 months in the Caribbean. I didn't have a whole lot of time, and I was actually on a base sitting around. And they don't let you sit around. You're always doing training, or you're cleaning something, or you're out doing exercises, like combat practices kind of thing. So there's a lot of waiting in the military. Yeah, if you're unfortunately,
thank you for taking your time and filling us.
Well, you're very welcome. You took me back down memory lane, so that was nice to meet you.
In most events where American lives are lost, we have a day of remembrance in honor of the bloodshed. In the case of the Vietnam War, there are a multitude of memorials and remembrance days for our veterans who served. We remember the lives lost to war, but also celebrate the innocent lives saved by our American soldiers. There are memorials dedicated to the Vietnam War in many cities, including our own Philadelphia. It is important to honor those who have served, both alive and those who have passed. Through celebration and sorrow, we honor their memory and show them how much we appreciate what they have done not only for their country, but for those around the world as well. Heroes like these veterans and our interviewee today deserve all the recognition and love we can provide after all of their service and sacrifice. So, on behalf of all the students of the Wissahickon School District, thank you, veterans.